Hello guys, if you are among those people that always believe that thermal physics is very difficult, oh, I can't know, thermal physics, the formulas are very difficult, or you always feel that transformer questions are extremely hard. Now, this video is going to talk about transformer and thermal physics in a way that you will understand. Now, don't forget, this is prep class physics online class, and we shall be tackling JAMB Physics 2016 question number 1 to number 5, and we shall be destroying it. We shall show no mercy. Now, don't forget, if you learn something from this video, click on like button. We have much content to share with you that will better help you understand physics. And let's get to the question number one. Now, question number one says, what is the least possible error encountered when taking measurement with a meter rule? Do you have any idea which one might be correct? Do you think it is 0.5 millimeter or 1.0 or 0.2 or 0.1? For a meter rule. Now, I'll show you everything right now. Now, if it were a meter rule, the accuracy is 0.1. Now, the accuracy means the least error that can be permitted, that can be encountered. So that's accuracy. So it is 0.1 what centimeter. Now, but you must change, you know, all our answers are in millimeter. So we must change them into millimeter. And you know that 10 millimeter make 1 centimeter, right? So you have to change them into millimeter by multiplying them by 10. So now the first one is 0.1 for a measuring tape. So 0.1 times 10 is going to become what? It's going to become 1 millimeter. Then also the same accuracy for meter is also 0.1, and 0.1 times 10 is 1 millimeter, and that's the answer. Meter rule's accuracy is 1 millimeter. It's just 1 millimeter. Then when you come to vernier caliper, it is now the accuracy is 0.01, which is equivalent to 0.1 millimeter. Then micrometer is also the same thing as, it's also it's actually 0.1 millimeter on its own. So that's just it. So but my micrometer is 0.01 millimeter. So micrometer is 0.01. Why vernier caliper is 0.1. Why meter rule and measuring tape are 1 millimeter. So the answer for meter rule is 1 millimeter, and that makes option 1 millimeter, and that makes option B the correct answer to that question. The answer is 1 millimeter. Don't forget, both meter rule and tape rule use 1 millimeter accuracy, while your caliper use 0.1 millimeter, while your micrometer is the worst, it uses 0.01, and that's the smallest accuracy among the length measuring instrument. They are all instruments for measuring length: meter rule, caliper, micrometer, measuring tape. Hope you know that micrometer is for measuring very small length, extremely tiny, and that's why its own accuracy is 0.01, because it can measure very tiny length, like the thickness of a book. Okay, but caliper is used for measuring cylindrical, like tin of milk or your test tube. Caliper is used for measuring things that are cylinder shape. Okay, why meter rule is for measuring short length, why tape rule is for measuring long length, maybe of book or of tape or whatever. So that's just it. They are all length measuring instruments. Now, number two, the electromotive force in the secondary winding is what? Now, we have primary winding and we have secondary winding. This is a transformer. This thing you are looking at is called, in science, in physics, it's called a transformer. It has two windings, primary and secondary. Now, the electromotive force in the secondary, that's the voltage, or the EMF, sorry, in the secondary winding is what? Is it stabilizing, reducing, increasing, or varying? Do you have any idea? Now, actually, you just have to look at it, transformer formula. Vs over Vp equals Ns over Np. Now, that means that whenever the windings increase, okay, the EMF will also increase. The answer to that question is simply increase. And I will tell you why. Once you know this, then you've really understand quite some things, a lot about transformer. Now, first of all, I want you to know the transformer formula. Vs over Vp equals Ns over Np. What's my V? Voltage or EMF, okay? EMF, Vs means secondary EMF, while Vp means primary EMF. Then NS means secondary windings. Then NP means primary winding. Now look at this. This means that since it is VS over VP equals NS over NP, that means what happened to voltage V happens to N also, because they both have S and S on top and P under. That means they are like friends. Okay, now that means if voltage increase, windings also we need to what increase. What I mean is that if windings increase, voltage or EMF will also increase. Now look at this winding here. In the primary section, it is smaller winding. Can you see? It's not much. But in the secondary section, it is larger winding. So the number of winding has increased. So what will happen to the voltage at this point? Now, we said from the formula that if windings increase, voltage too will increase, because two of them are friends. They are very good friends. So what happened to windings on the transformer will also affect the voltage. So that means if you want to build a transformer that will have high volt, just increase the winding. Then the voltage will also follow. That means increase the amount of turns this will take. This wire will move around. If you move around more, there will be higher voltage. Okay, now that means this is the primary winding. This is the secondary winding. So the secondary winding will increase because the turns have increased, or the windings. Sorry, the secondary EMF, sorry, that's voltage, will increase because the windings at the secondary points has also increased. So secondary, like I said, secondary EMF will increase at this point because this is the secondary part. Now the secondary EMF will increase because the secondary winding is more than the primary winding. So it will lead to an increase. Secondary winding will increase the EMF. It will increase the EMF because from the formula of transformer, voltage and windings are friends. They follow each other. That means they are directly proportional to each other. And that is the answer to the question. Let's take out number three. If a pump is capable of lifting 500 grams of water through a vertical height of 60 meters in 15 minutes, the power of the pump is what? Now, do you have any idea what power is? Now, when you were in year one of the senior secondary class, that's SS1, you were taught about power, right? Work, energy, and power. Can you still remember? Now, power has a formula that says what? Now, power has a formula that says work over time. Or now this is what it means. Power is just work over time. Power is work over time. That means the rate of work you could do per time is the amount of power you have. So that means the smaller the time it takes you to do that work, means then the higher the power you have. So that means that powerful people don't spend enough time doing work. A powerful man spends little time doing large work. So that means a powerful man is a man who can do a lot of work within a short time. Now that's what the power formula is saying. Work divided by time. That is small time but large work. And that's what we have. Then work can be broken down into force times distance. Can you see that? Work itself is force times distance. So power is therefore force times distance over time. Now in the question, we were given what? We were given 5,000 kilograms. Sorry, we were given 5,000 kilograms of water, and the height is what? 60 meter in 15 minutes. That's the time. So now I just went on to say I must change this mass into force. Now, how do you change mass into force? You multiply by 10. So I'll say force is therefore mass times acceleration due to gravity. The mass is 5,000, the gravity is 10. Okay, that will give me 50,000 newton. So the total work, force is 50,000 newton. I change this 5,000 kilogram into force. You know, mass can change into force by times it by 10. So that 10 is what your G, acceleration due to gravity. So it makes 50,000 newton. That's my force. Then my distance, it went through a height of 60 meter. That's my distance. 60 meter. Then my time is in minutes. Now any time in physics given to you in minutes is a trap. Time is not measured in minutes in science. Time is measured in seconds. So you have to change that minute into seconds. If you know, some people might just say 15 minutes, and that's just easy, just plug in the 15 and fill it. That is the fastest way to fill it. You must change the 15 into seconds. That will become 15 times 60, and that will make 900 seconds, right? Now, plug in all the parameters. So I have power is force times distance over time. What's my force? 50,000. What's my distance that I got before? 60. What's my time that I changed here? 900 seconds. That's 900 seconds. Then multiply. 50,000 times 60, that is actually what? That's 3 million. Okay, that is 3 million divided by 900, and that will give me 3.3. Now, 0 cancels 0, 0 cancels 0. I'll have, I want to do, I just did 30 over 9, and that's 3.3. Then these three zeros, 0, 0, 0, that's times 10 raised to the power 3. 3.3 times 10 raised to the power 3 joule per seconds. And that is it. Even if you get your answer, now this is the way to go about getting your answer, and that is the way you get your answer for this question. And that's it with number 3. So the answer is 3.3 times 10 to the power 10 joule per seconds. Full stop. Let's check out number 4. Calculate the temperature change when 500 joule of it is supplied to 100 gram of water. This is easy, super easy. Now the simple thing here is that the question is asking for temperature change. This is thermal physics. Now, many people, when they see questions on thermal physics, they begin to freak out. But actually, this is just easy. Now, the simple thing is that there's one master formula for any question on thermal physics or thermal capacity. It is anything heat, okay, in physics, work around this formula. H equals MC change in temperature. This is the master formula. And this is the formula for thermal capacity in physics. So now H equals MC theta, where my theta is my change in theta. Okay, so I have MC theta, my H is my thermal capacity, and it was given to me in the question as 500 joule. That's it there. Then my M is my mass. The mass was given to me 100 gram is 0.1 kilogram. You might be saying, how did I change? Just divide it by 1,000, you'll be getting 0.1, because mass is not measured in gram. Another trap. So you must know units. Mass is not measured in gram. It must be changed into kilogram. Divide by 1,000. Divide that 100 by 1,000, you will get 0.1 kilogram. And that is your mass. Then the next thing is my C. My C means specific heat capacity of water, because you are dealing with water. Okay, now the specific heat capacity of water is always given. You don't have to cram it. But in this question, I don't know whether it's a typo. It wasn't given. So generally, it is 4,200 joule per Kelvin per kilogram per Kelvin. And that's the specific heat capacity of water. 4,200. Okay, now plug it in. But we are told to find the change in heat. So make the change in heat the subject. So that means I will remove this MC and bring them under the H. So that will become change in heat equals H over M times C, right? Now, what's my H? My heat capacity is 500. What's my mass? My mass in the question is 0.1. What's my thermal capacity? My specific heat capacity of water. And that's 4,200. So 500 over 0.1 times 4,200 is 420. Okay? So that gives me 500 over 420 is 1.2 degrees Celsius. And that is my change of heat. 1.2 degrees Celsius. And that settles number 4. And that is the answer. Don't forget the formula. Very important. Any question on thermal capacity or heat in physics can be handled by this formula. Take note of this formula. H equals MC change in theta. And that is just it. Let's check out number 5. Which of the following particle cannot be deflected by an electric or magnetic field? Do you have any idea? Gamma ray, alpha ray, wave particle, beta particle. They are all wave particles. So wave particle is out. Now, but one of them is stronger than electric and magnetic field. Do you have any idea which one is right? Now, actually, let's take a look at it. The answer there is gamma. Now, gamma ray is very stubborn. That means alpha ray can be deflected, although alpha ray is heavy. Okay? Alpha ray is always positively charged because it has proton and neutron. But beta ray is negative, and beta ray is made up of electrons only, and beta ray is very light. Beta ray can be deflected very well by anything, okay, because it's very light, and electron has no mass. But proton and neutron, they are heavy, and they are positively charged and they have mass, and therefore they can't be deflected easily. They can be deflected, but not easily. Okay, but gamma ray is electromagnetic ray. It is an electromagnetic wave. Okay, that means that it does not travel through any material medium. That means it travels through vacuum or nothing. So gamma ray is in its own world. It is unaffected by anything called electric field and magnetic field. It can travel in their field, but it will not be affected by them because they can't sense him. It's like gamma ray, let me just say that gamma ray is invisible. It is invisible to electric and magnetic field. Electric field and magnetic field can see alpha ray, they can see beta ray, but they can't see gamma ray because gamma ray is invisible to their eyes. So that means gamma ray cannot be deflected by electric field and magnetic field. And that's what we have there. Properties of gamma ray. Number one, not deflected by magnetic or electric field, because it's very strong. You know, when you talk about gamma, you are talking about that guy. You remember, it always reminds me of that guy, that green orc smash. Okay, you know that guy? That guy was gamma ray, right? Now, it is not deflected by magnetic and electric field. It has no charge. It is chargeless. It is not positive. Like I said, alpha is positive, beta is negative, but gamma is chargeless. Number three, it's a poor ionizing ability. It has poor ionizing ability. It does not make you charge. It does not easily ionize you. So it does not easily ionize. Then it is fast moving. It is fast moving, similar to the speed of light. It can move with the speed of light because it is electromagnetic. Okay, and all electromagnetic guys can move almost at the speed of light. So it moves very fast. Okay, it has eye penetrating ability. It can penetrate more than alpha, more than beta. It can penetrate farther. It can penetrate through paper. It can penetrate through aluminum. It can penetrate through lead a little. It can only be stopped by double lead. Okay, now it has eye penetrating power. These are all about the story and the history and the life history of Mr. Gamma Ray. And it is very harmful to the human tissue. When absorbed, it can cause cancer. Okay, so that's gamma ray for you. So the answer is gamma ray. It is non-deflected by any of the magnetic or electric field. And that brings us to the end of this video. Don't forget, if you learn something from this video, click on the like button. We have more content to share with you that will better help you understand physics. Until we see you next time, guys, take care of yourself and bye for now.